All right. Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon. We did have lunch. Good afternoon. It's good to be with all of you all. I'm Carrie Cook. I'm our Community Affairs Officer and Vice President of Community Development for the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. It's a joy to be here with you all, and thank you to all who are joining us via live stream for today's Fed Listens, Transitioning to a Post-Pandemic Economy. At this time, I'm going to bring up our Bank President, Tom Barkin.
I want to thank everybody for joining us today. A special thanks to Governor Mickey Bowman right here and our three panelists who are all taking time out of their busy calendars to help us understand the economy a little bit better. So those of you in the room are getting an up-close look at our home base here in Richmond. For those of you who are online, I want to paint the picture. We're in a great location in downtown Richmond. We overlook the James River. The view is spectacular. Our building is a focal point for collaboration, for learning, and for connection. And quite literally, it's an ivory tower. For those of us here, the building reminds us every day that we can't be limited to what we learn within the walls. We can't understand the economy from our desks, so we orient ourselves outwards. My colleagues and I, and several of them are in the room today, are on the ground continually in the Fed's 5th District. Last year, we had over 1,700 engagements with bankers, business leaders, community leaders, workers, and public officials. These meetings have taken us to every corner of our district, from Charleston, South Carolina to Charleston, West Virginia, from Rocky Mount to Rock Hill, from Charlotte to Charlottesville. And we share this commitment with the entire Federal Reserve System. We all make the effort to, well, to listen. And that's how these Fed Listens events emerged in 2019. The listening matters to those of us who need to understand the economy. The data we get comes in late. It's then revised multiple times. It's aggregated, which gives you a limited ability to drill down. And it's notoriously poor at identifying turning points when players in the economy start to pull back or double down. In contrast, our investment in listening helps us better evaluate what's happening, to whom, and why. We make better decisions with better understanding. So that's a reminder that it's time for me to stop talking and start listening. Thanks in advance to all of you for your time and your insights. We value and depend on you greatly. Thank you. And now let me introduce Governor Mickey Bowman. He'll say a few words. Governor Bowman joined the Board of Governors in 2018, and she's been a driving force behind these Fed Listens events, which are happening in every bank across the country. She's a lifetime community banker who, prior to her appointment to the board, also served as the State Bank Commissioner of Kansas. Mickey, welcome to Richmond.
Well, thanks so much, Tom. It's really a pleasure to be here in Richmond. And Carrie, I want to really thank you and your team for putting together such an incredible event and for our participants as well. I really look forward to our conversation. So it's really a pleasure to join you here in Richmond today to take part in today's conversations. When we started Fed Listens back in 2019, the initiative was part of a broad, comprehensive review of the decision-making framework that we use to pursue our monetary policy goals of maximum employment and price stability. We met with people across the country from a wide range of backgrounds and perspectives, and we learned a lot about how our monetary policy actions affect them, their businesses, and their communities. In light of the valuable insights that we gained in those original listening sessions, we decided to expand the scope of Fed Listens to become an ongoing process of consultation with the public. I look forward to hearing the perspectives from today's participants, our panelists, as well as those of you who are here with us in the audience in person today. Through Fed Listens and our other board and system convenings, we're able to gain important insights about economic conditions by engaging directly with those who are experiencing the economy directly. Your views and experiences supplement the economic data, as Tom said, that we monitor, providing important color and context. These discussions help us gain a better and deeper understanding of the ongoing burden from high inflation, from the considerations for families in making spending decisions, to the factors that are weighed by businesses and business owners in applying for loans to make capital investments like new buildings or equipment to expand their operations. These conversations help us to look beneath the national level data to see how Americans in different areas of the country are faring. I'm sure that some of the issues and challenges that we'll hear about today are unique to the Federal Reserve's 5th District, while other themes will be broadly similar to those that are experienced in different areas of the country. This local perspective is one of the great advantages of the Federal Reserve's regional structure and that of the Fed Listens Initiative. The conversations that we have here today also help inform our thinking as we head into the next meeting of the Federal Open Market Committee. Inflation has come down, but we know that it's still too high, and it can be especially difficult for those who are least able to manage the higher costs of essentials like food, housing, and transportation. My colleagues and I are highly focused on returning inflation to 2%. Our ability to deliver on that goal depends importantly on being able to separate the short-term effects of temporary events from longer-term structural shifts in the economy. The pandemic experience abruptly changed the lives of most Americans and their families, and it has altered many long-standing economic patterns that policymakers have relied upon to interpret economic developments. One example of this is the major shift in the composition of spending by American consumers that we've seen in the past few years. In the decades before the pandemic, we observed a slow but steady decline in the share of aggregate consumer spending that was comprised of goods and a corresponding increase in the share of services and total spending. In the first 2 years after the onset of the pandemic, the balance of spending moved back substantially towards goods and away from services. Though this wasn't particularly surprising given the lockdowns and the fact that so many businesses in the services sector were shut down. What has been somewhat surprising, however, is that the relative strength in goods spending has persisted, rather than reverting to its pre-pandemic trends. The pattern that we see in the U.S. is also unusual relative to other advanced economies, where the composition of goods versus services spending appears to have returned to historical norms. There are a number of potential explanations for these newly emerging spending patterns, some that would likely be temporary and others that may be more lasting. For example, the strong sales of computers, televisions, and video game consoles this year might reflect some ongoing pent-up demand following earlier supply shortages, or they might reflect a permanent change in preferences for those goods due to the greater amount of time many of us are still spending at home. But given their varied experiences and leadership roles in sectors including retail, hospitality, and healthcare, I'm sure that our panelists, and indeed all of you in the audience today, have observed these and other changes in your own lives, your businesses, and your communities since the pandemic. Sharing those observations during today's discussions will help us do our best as policymakers to promote a strong and vibrant economy. So with that, I'd like to say thank you again to Tom and to your team here in the Richmond Fed, Carrie, and thanks for the opportunity to be a part of the discussion.
Thanks, Governor Bowman. We appreciate those opening remarks, and we will dig more into some of the trends and economic conditions that you discussed with our panel here today. As we get started, I want to remind those on the live stream that the Federal Reserve Bank's 5th district includes South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia, West Virginia, Maryland, and Washington, D.C. The folks here on our panel will help us to have some perspective around economic and community conditions within our 5th district geography, and we really appreciate the panel that's going to join us. They're a fun bunch, so I think you'll hear some interesting perspective. And also, again, this is Fed Listens, so we want to continue to hear from you all. As we go through the panel discussion, we'll specifically talk to our panelists for about 45 minutes, and then after that, we'll transition into small table breakouts where we'll ask you a couple of follow-on questions and then have you report out to Tom and Governor Bowman about what you're hearing around community and economic conditions. So this is really intended to be an inclusive conversation, a conversation with all of your perspectives. And we're going to jump in immediately to start with our panel. So let me introduce our panel. To my immediate left is Neil Amin, who is the CEO of Shamin Hotels. He is right here based in Richmond, and I just learned also grew up in Richmond. So it's great to have you with us. Thanks for being here, Neil.
for having me.
And then we've got to his left, Nancy Thomas, who is the CEO of In Unison, formerly the Retail Merchants Association. And Nancy is doing a lot of great work with independent retailers in the Richmond area. Thanks for being with us, Nancy. Next is Kevin Price. Kevin is the CEO of the National Minority Economic Development Institute, aka the Institute. And Kevin, we really appreciate the perspective that you bring as both someone who is directly lending to consumers, but also understands trends that are happening with households. So thank you for what you'll share with us today, Kevin. Okay, awesome. So we're going to jump right into our conversation. I've got a couple of questions for our panel teed up, but then we're going to, again, think about how we continue to incorporate some of the things we heard from Tom and Governor Bowman, as well as you all. So Nancy, I'd love to start with you because you've just completed a survey from some of the independent retailers that you work with in the area, in the Richmond area. Can you share with our audience, what did the survey reveal to you about consumer temperament, and what is top of mind for local independent business community leaders? So how are retailers thinking in this economic environment?
Thanks, Carrie. Can you hear me okay? Good. All right. So and thanks for that introduction. So In Unison, formerly known as Retail Merchants Association, when we shifted this model to only helping local independent business, we understood that research was going to be a key element in helping this small group of local businesses. And so we have really leaned into research. Our Vice President, Diane McMahon, is here with us today. That's why I have paper. These guys were like, why do you have all those notes? I said, because I have to read these percentages correct, or else I'm going to get called out. So, but thank you for all this great research. And our goals around this research are really three things. It's to, you know, inform, benchmark, and influence. And when I say influence, the influence is to help these folks look at this data that they've provided and to not feel alone and to feel like they can create frameworks of decision making to employ into the future. We did two surveys. Diana curated a survey back in June. We published it in July. That was very comprehensive. Several of you at the Fed have that. The second survey, Carrie and I decided, let's do something within the last week and a half and really find out what the sentiments are of the consumer and the businesses. The key, one of the key elements here is we didn't want to put it out to a 30, 60, 90 day like you normally ask. We wanted it in the last 30 days. We wanted real-time sentiments. So I'm going to read, we asked them only four questions. So let me just read those real quickly to you. So the first one, and they can only pick one. Which of the following describe consumer demand sentiments in the last 30 days? 29% of our respondents, customers are buying less. 23.5% customer traffic has decreased. 23.5% also, customers are complaining about price increases, but they're still buying. So that's a key element there. And then 17.6, customers are delaying purchases or postponing projects because of tightening budgets. We had a couple of respondents who were in the construction industry, and so we really tried to reach out to very different industries. So I think that's where that particular one might be coming. But we also had 6% of people saying customer traffic has increased. So, you know, that there's some positive there. The second question we asked, and they can only pick one answer on this as well, how would you rate customer spending in the last 30 days? 41.2% customer spending is down. 29.4 customer spending has been up. I think that's good. 29.4 customer spending is flat. So between your flat and your down, obviously those percentages are a little bit higher, but I think it's encouraging to see that close to 30%, you know, are seeing some increase in sales. Along with this, I, you know, follow Governor Bowman and Tom's good lead about, you know, be foot soldiers in this industry and get out there and talk to people. We do that a lot. So I went ahead in the last 48 hours and called about six or eight local businesses, made sure they were varying industries and also demographic sections of Richmond. So I don't misrepresent, I'm going to read. So what are they thinking? I think that's, may I answer that second part?
Absolutely.
All right. Speaking to multiple businesses, the concern of the economy is heightened. I heard that across the board. These are some quotes. Seeing a lull since mid-September, week over week for sales. That's really key. And they made a point of saying that. They said, you know, we can have a bad week or a bad Saturday, but then we know we're going to make it up. And they're starting to see that week over week. Less traffic in our stores as well as shopping districts. Challenge as to how to stay on top of pricing. And we're going to talk a little bit about those other two questions that we just fed our local businesses was around operation costs. Raising price, this is a very interesting quote. And I really thought about it. One of our local businesses said, you know what, Nancy? Managing pricing is really hard because when we raise prices, we're raising prices on our neighbors. Think about that. And they said, that's a really hard perception to manage if you're a local business serving a local community. Right? I mean, you know, when you think about it that way. One said, how long will this lull last? I usually depend upon November and December with an increase in holiday revenue to take me through Q1 of 2024. They're worried about Q1 already because with softening sales, typically that happens in that Q1 for retailers. They depend upon that heavy impact of revenue during the holiday to carry them through. Theft is at an all-time high. I heard that across the board. And I think all of you probably hear a lot about the organized retail crime that's going on in our country and the safety concerns. Consumers are very focused on pricing. They're not buying for themselves. And I always talk about this notion that, and I ask my team this sometimes when they say, hey, how about this? I say, is it nice or is it necessary? And I think that's a notion that maybe subconsciously our consumer is thinking through when they're thinking about buying. And then the other thing that was really interesting is, and I heard this from a few, people are really looking at their receipts. They're questioning service fees. They're just looking at that bottom. They're saying, well, there's the tax, but what's this? So, you know, that's also a very interesting observation that our businesses are making. So, again, this research really helps them become more intentional about listening and observing consumer behavior.
Thank you for sharing that, Nancy. I think when you talk about people looking at receipts, we hear from communities oftentimes as we're out and about that, you know, households are making different decisions now as it relates to their own balance sheet, and communities are thinking differently about how to fund and finance projects. Neil, I want to move to you because you've just come from the opening of a new hotel in Towson, Maryland, and your portfolio continues to expand. So when you think about the expansion that you're experiencing in post-pandemic occupancy rates at your properties, as well as just guest preferences and demographics, can you talk a little bit about how that is showing up within your business?
Sure. Yeah, happy to do so. One of the benefits that we have is that we have a broad portfolio that operates in all different geographies. We have hotels in Virginia Beach. We have hotels in Maryland, North Carolina, Tidewater, Roanoke. So we see a lot of different things. And what we've really seen is a big divergence in terms of the recovery and when the recovery happened in different parts of the district. And it's really interesting. I can take you back to 2020 at the height of the pandemic. For the Commonwealth of Virginia, where the bulk of our hotels were, revenues declined by 50% for 2020. Now, of that 50%, we saw a 65% decline in Northern Virginia, which you can imagine is more dependent upon corporate travel and the federal government. Conversely, we saw only a 30% decline in Virginia Beach, which is at the opposite end of the spectrum and heavily dependent upon leisure travel. And then if you take a step 1 year forward to 2021, after people became vaccinated or started to become vaccinated, wanted to come out of their homes, Virginia Beach was actually 15% above 2019. So our industry tends to use 2019 as a barometer, as the last real kind of data point. And it's shocking that Virginia Beach was actually 15%, had 15% higher revenue than 2019. Conversely, Northern Virginia was slow to recover and was still down about 50% in 2021 compared to 2019. And then if you take another step forward to 2022, you continue to see these trends reverse as business travel comes back and people pare down maybe some of that leisure travel. So Northern Virginia went from a 50% decline to an 80% decline. So they made up about 30% of that decrease in 2022. And coming to today, they're basically flat. Through the third quarter, Northern Virginia has the same revenue as it had in 2019. Now that's on a nominal basis. Obviously, that's not on a real basis, which is another challenge. And then the other thing that we're looking at, obviously, is when is leisure peaked, you know, and when are we going to start seeing that turn negative? And thankfully, at Virginia Beach, again, is my data point, 2022, we still saw a 1.5% increase from 2021. Now, we did see, if you peel back the onion, we did see some differences among the different price points of the hotels. Typically, the lower priced hotels started seeing declines in 2022 as maybe some of that stimulus wore off and people dipped into their savings, whereas the upper tier hotels still continue to perform in 2022. And then fast forward to 2023 till today, Virginia Beach is still up about 1%. So many of us had expected that market to start declining this year. We haven't seen it yet, thankfully. So again, I think maybe the bottom tier hotels probably saw some of that decline, but the upper tier hotels had group business come back. And then I may just add one more thing. I know a lot of us are focused on price levels. You know, we're talking about inflation, and I was talking about revenue. But if you think about the price levels, Virginia Beach, which has, you know, obviously done the best, room rates are about 18% higher than they were in 2019. So still, you know, based on my math, a little bit less than CPI. So a lot of people talk about the resurgence of travel and, you know, hotels charging a lot more, but really on a nominal basis, we're pretty much, you know, right at CPI or maybe even a little bit less. And then for the whole state, it's probably about 15%. So, you know, I think there's still a lot of runway. And looking forward, I was just talking with Tom before we sat down here that we're seeing a lot of optimism on the corporate side for next year, because there's typically a lag on corporate rates and corporate negotiated rates. Hoteliers have to have optimism in order to ask for an additional increase. And now that optimism is there, we're actually asking for an additional increase next year. And we're expecting a double digit increase in room rates, at least for corporate and group for next year. And the other thing I would just mention is we also track the federal per diem. So obviously Virginia is very dependent upon federal business and the military. And the federal per diem increased 9% this fiscal year, which started October 1, 2023. So automatically you're going to have a 9% bump pretty much, you know, for in room rates for this next 12 months.
Thank you for sharing, Neil, about some of the macro conditions that you're seeing and specifically what you're seeing in certain markets. When you think about just micro consumer decisions and, you know, folks coming and staying at properties, Nancy mentioned the nice to have versus the necessary. Are folks trading down? Are they still traveling but trading down when it comes to food and beverage or other things that come along with the leisure travel?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. It's something that we're monitoring. You know, I think we're seeing two different themes there. One, people were very focused on health and safety during the pandemic, rightfully so. You know, Hilton announced a clean stay program, Marriott announced their own program. And I think some of that is still in people's minds. So they're really looking for quality. So we're not seeing people trade down on the price level, try and save some money on that, because they're still focused on making sure I have a clean hotel, a safe hotel, great service. I think that's extremely important. You're going to see a lot of winners and losers coming out of this environment, where people that have maintained their properties, provide great service, are still going to outperform and can charge more than maybe people that haven't. But where we are seeing the trade-off is when somebody comes to our hotel, they may spend less, as you mentioned, on food and beverage. So we're seeing definitely that spend decline, whether it's because people are bringing their own amenities or they're using delivery service. Nowadays, if you go to a hotel, you'll see, you know, piles of, you know, bags, you know, at the front desk, people picking up their own items. But, you know, as I was looking into this, I checked ABC's information, the Alcoholic Beverage Control Authority, to see what their numbers were. And surprisingly, from 2021 to 20, they increased 13%. Their sales increased 13%. But from 2022 to 2021, their sales only increased 2.9%. So it may be something that's happening kind of broad based too. You know, people are, you know, substituting different items.
Yep, very interesting. I was in Washington, D.C. yesterday at the Opportunity Finance Network National Conference, and I saw a salad on the menu at the hotel, and I thought, Uber Eats probably has a cheaper salad than this. So to your point, there were no good.
Oh, gosh.
As I looked, there was a small business around the corner that had a much cheaper salad, and it was delicious. So, you know, I think people are definitely weighing these decisions and, you know, trying to figure out what works for them for their travel, right, and making it fit accordingly. Kevin, I want to come to you. Kevin was also at the Opportunity Finance Network Conference, and hundreds of leaders convened in Washington to focus on capital access and credit access in under-resourced and disinvested communities, and how capital can really meet purpose in this moment and in these economic conditions. So, Kevin, you know, you also recently hosted your own conference, the annual National Minority Economic Development Conference, and you're tracking what's happening with the small businesses that you lend to and also the households that you partner with through your different programs. Can you talk about what you're seeing in terms of economic conditions, particularly with low and moderate income consumers and small businesses?
So the Institute is 37 years old, and I haven't been there that long. But I've been around it since the early 90s, building the portable housing and then becoming a banker and now leading the Institute. And that conference is our executive networking conference. About 400 or 500 people come to that, governors, lots of elected officials at all levels. And we're really there to talk shop around economic development as it relates to minorities and women. And a few things have come out of that, especially the last few years. I started with the Institute March the 9th of 2020. I had 1 week and all of a sudden COVID hit. It was truly baptism by fire. And I called the chair of the board and said, I'm shutting the office down. And he ran over literally to the office and said, what do you mean? What are you doing? And I said, I'm sending everyone home to keep them safe. And that's how we began this journey of a new or reimagining how the Institute supports diverse business owners. I also commissioned our Research Policy and Impact Center to start studying what was happening. And we published those reports. We sent them out to the governors of the five states we have concentration in. We sent it out to other elected officials. And the governor of North Carolina's office called and said, okay, we're looking at your report. This isn't good. This is actually quite scary. What can we do? And essentially what we were sharing is that we were on parity with the Washington Post report back then that said that we were losing somewhere around 41% of African-American-owned businesses nationwide and another 36% of Hispanic businesses nationwide. And so how do you stop that trend? So we created the first ever grant program for diverse business owners in North Carolina's history. We gave away $41 million in 2 years to over 2,000 businesses, touching all 100 counties of North Carolina. Some of these counties, I didn't realize there were diverse business owners there, but we found them and we made sure they stayed alive, because part of what the results that we were finding was that the runway was getting shorter and shorter. And so as you had the federal government say, you all need to stay home. Well, for retailers, that's not a great thing. And so we saw those numbers continue to dwindle. And so access to capital became a big issue for us to grapple with. But then in rural counties, we also saw that they didn't have access to even the internet. So how do I sell my product if you're telling everyone to stay home and I don't have access to broadband, I don't have digital access? So they essentially were locked out. And we saw many of them go away as a result of that. That's devastating for small rural communities. And so I think that's an area where we can stake a claim in the ground and start to do some work. The other was, I think we were not paying attention to those businesses that actually did well during the pandemic. Not everyone did poorly. And so for those who did well, they started to reimagine their business, start thinking about international business. And so this past executive networking conference back in August, we had the ambassador to Tanzania join us. And she started talking about how much rice they buy alone was astounding. And their number one buyer, producer of rice for Tanzania and the 8 countries surrounding it is a supplier out of Arkansas. Who would have thought? And so we started thinking maybe it's time for us to do a trade mission to Tanzania. So I think that's another area of opportunity for us to think about international trade, but including African countries and including diverse business owners.
Thank you for sharing that and the way in which you all supported capital access for folks in a critical time during the pandemic. You also, you and I had a chance to catch up recently when we think about what's happening with households and we think about household cash balances and we see things like student loan payments coming back online and other spending and decisions that households have to make. Can you talk about any impact that you've seen and how that's showed up in people's personal loans or business loans and their ability to get capital, especially in a higher cost of capital environment?
Well, the founder of the Institute, her name was Andrea Harris. She passed away in 2020. But in 2016, she was doing studies on the impact of student loan debt on minority students in particular, and how they're saddled with so much debt that delays starting a business, that delays buying a home. And since I have 3 kids, that's a problem. I need them to move out and be successful. You, those of you who are parents know what I mean. We're now the open nesters, which is another new term I learned, means they return home again. And so I think that's been part of the challenge is how do we now grapple with student loan debt coming back online, payments coming back online, and so many kids are returning home from college. They're returning home because they want a different lifestyle than they saw their parents or their grandparents live. And I think lots of things will change in terms of how we respond to that generation of potential employees.
Worker demographics, particularly with younger workers. One of the things we did last year was a worker voices survey, and I think it was one of the first times that the Fed was really intentional about going out instead of getting monetary policy and worker conditions from the heads of businesses talking directly to workers themselves. And certainly how people want to work has shifted, particularly for younger generations. So I think it's, to your point, something to continue to watch. Nancy, as folks are back in the nest, maybe or maybe they don't have more disposable income to be able to use as they're returning home. But when you think about what your businesses are seeing, you talked some earlier about pricing and operating costs. How are small businesses and retailers planning around pricing and inventory and other business operations? Because all of those things go into the stability or viability long term and then the short term planning of the business. How are they preparing for that in this kind of matrixed environment?
So this is the second part of that very short survey we just did. And again, I'm going to, you know, read these stats. So the one question, and they only had an opportunity to pick one answer. No, actually, they could pick more than one, excuse me. So which of the following are you currently experiencing or have experienced in the last 3 months? And they could pick more than one. Cost of goods have increased 82%. General business expenses have increased 76%. Other business has increased, our business has increased prices 47%. Said, yeah, we've done that. Our business has reduced inventory 17.6%. And, you know, that may seem like a low number, and it's not, and I'm going to talk a little bit about this later, is that, you know, there was an overreaction to inventory and purchasing during the pandemic and thereafter because of the supply chain. You know, people were kind of hoarding inventory to make sure that they had it on the shelves. And then we also put this in because what we're finding, particularly during COVID, you really found out who your loyal vendors were. You know, who were those people that were going to extend you some credit so that you could, you know, spread your revenue across other factors of your business. like keeping your people safe and, you know, supplying all the PPP and, you know, all that. So about 6% have discontinued relationships with vendors because they no longer feel like they've got their backs. And that's really important for a small business because, you know, sometimes remember, a small business community has to stay competitive in the marketplace. And their, their value proposition is, what do I bring uniquely to my community that other maybe large national companies do not? Then the last question, the fourth question that we asked is, and again, they could pick more than one answer. If you haven't already, do you plan to do any of the following in the next 3 months? Increase prices. 47% will increase, 40% of the survey takers will increase prices. And I want to bring back the data that we had in July and reference that. That first survey, we talked about how are you adjusting to the economic, headwinds. And at that point, and that wasn't long ago, those who wanted to increase prices was only at 29%. So that's a really key number. And again, this is why we really wanted to keep this in real time, Carrie, like we talked about. And also this last 30-day period is important for us because remember, we don't want to mix in the back-to-school revenue that always gives our economy an uptick in this time of year. So that was an important. The other one was, are you, improving efficiencies? 35%, yes, we're going to improve efficiencies. Reduce inventory, 35% will reduce inventory. So now, that whole buying, hoarding is starting to really level out. It has already leveled out with a lot of companies. And then some have said increase wages, 29% will increase wages, which I think is promising, but also I think that tells you another story. The last choice they had was, will you reduce staff? And 11, close to 12% said, we will reduce staff. So, just again, I'm going to give you some anecdotal information. When I spoke to people in the last 48 hours, many more are passing the increase of the cost of goods to the consumer. Sorry to say that to all of you, but that, you probably feel that and see that. Some are really analyzing their costs, and like I said before, when you increase price, you're increasing prices on your neighbors. And so what they're looking at is anyone giving me a discount on shipping or freight, and can I take that savings and pass it on to the, can I pass it on to my customer? Keeping my margin numbers in place, but also how can I not be perceived as just constantly increasing prices? And some of our businesses, I'm looking at one right in front of me, when you have like a 42% increase in things, your basic ingredient to something, you have no choice than to increase that price. So there's a lot of hard decision making going on. A lot more research, this is interesting, a lot more research on what neighboring stores are doing. And that goes back to vendor loyalty. And when I owned my business, I had a lot of loyal vendors. And when they started selling to my neighbors, that was very upsetting to me because that I lost that market share of that particular product. And so now they're having to go out and make sure that their pricing in their store is competitive because customers see that. And they're gonna lean into you and then they're gonna ask you for a discount. So the service industry, I made sure I talked to our service industry because, it goes back to what you opened with is it experience or is it product? And in the service industry, when you talk about, salons and other, things for, whether it's beauty or just events or anything like that, what they're finding is they always paid above minimum wage, always. And they're paying way above, Virginia's state legislation that just upped minimum wage. But what they're finding is they're going to retain those experienced and highly trained employees. They have to just keep bumping them up. And with that bump up comes a price increase to the customer. So it's not just cost of physical goods that you're buying and then you're reselling. It's also, highly trained people. that you, you know, you want to keep on your staff. So those are just a couple of anecdotal points to make.
Really important points you made there around, you know, those wage increases have additional effects, right, on the business and things that are passed on to consumers as well. Neil, I want to come to you a bit on the labor and labor costs piece in terms of what you're seeing in hospitality. And, you know, I talked earlier about our Worker Voices survey that was conducted with the Fed, talking directly to workers. And I think some of the fundamental things that came out of that survey is a shift in how at least a subsegment, maybe not the entire segment of workers, but a subsegment of workers want to work, and dignity that has to be present within the work, wages, but even some trade-offs with wages. So when you think about, would I rather earn this additional income here, or would I rather have some additional flexibility with the role? People are thinking about those things as they look at opportunities. What are you seeing in terms of labor with hospitality and labor costs within the industry?
It's a great point and great question. As you know, our industry was decimated, you know, during the pandemic in terms of our labor pool. And believe it or not, today we still employ as an industry, leisure and hospitality in the Commonwealth, 15% less people than we did in 2019. So we're still trying to play catch up and still, you know, trying to attract as many as we can. And it's not without trying. You know, our industry at Chemin Hotels, we've increased wages as much as 40% for the hardest working associates that take care of our guests, the frontline associates. And as an industry, when you think about managers and you add up everybody together in the Commonwealth, average hourly earnings have increased by 30% in leisure and hospitality. And then, you know, going back to my earlier comments, revenue has increased in the Commonwealth about 12%. And wages have increased by 30%. So clearly our margins have gone down. And we're happy to do this. We feel like, you know, we definitely want to retain and our workforce and see them grow. But to your question about flexibility, that's something that we're definitely are looking at. One of the things that we did is we implemented on-demand pay. And we did that really as a thought of, let's help people during emergencies. And what we found out was that the vast majority of our associates are using it. Mm-hmm. And so that was a nice benefit. It also, you know, if you think about it, makes you wonder, is it because they don't have savings that, you know, that's why they're using it? So that's something that we're looking into a little bit more. And we're actually providing courses around financial literacy to all of our associates so they can understand about how to save and how to maintain a budget. But we're doing whatever we can. We have a full-time benefits manager that we brought on board that scours, you know, retailers and works with them to talk about discounts for back to school. We did a great back to school program for our associates. Whatever we can do to make people feel valued and also feel part of the team is what we're really focused on.
Absolutely. As you navigate the current conditions, are there any headwinds that you see ahead that would change kind of what you're currently doing and thinking about in real time, what may transpire that's impacting those future decisions?
Sure. Yeah, you know, our biggest challenge, I say this a lot, is that our job requires people to be on site and our demand is typically weekends. And it's the hardest thing is because obviously people want to spend time with their friends and family on the weekend. So that's the biggest thing that we're trying to focus on. And, you know, how can we make it more flexible? How can we think about changing the shifts that we offer to make it more palatable? The other thing, we did a lot of research, our industry did, and where do we lose our workers to? And we found out that it was really the ride sharing companies and the delivery services. Because that is, you know, clearly extremely flexible, right? You can you know, log on and do a ride, and then you can go see your family the next hour. So we're trying to figure out how can we compete with those type of, you know, employers. And I think, you know, again, our industry says is that we have to provide that career path for people, show them that it's not just a job, but this is a career for you. And the best thing about the hospitality industry is that you don't need a degree. You know, you don't need that formal education. It's really about taking care of people and being hospitable, and people progress very rapidly.
That's great. During lunch, we had a chance to talk some about the paper ceiling and what is happening where, you know, do you actually need the credentials to move up? Do you need the credentials to continue to advance or to enter into the labor market? And some companies are rethinking their approach to this. Some companies are saying,
well, we have this scoped as you needed a bachelor's degree or you needed a associate's or a master's degree. Should we rescope this to tap into a broader labor market pool? And so thank you for mentioning how you all approach it and what's most important, which is caring about people and taking care of your customers. So appreciate that. Kevin, I want to come back to you because when you think about the way in which you all continue to do your lending and the fact that you operate several business centers and you operate as a CDFI, you've done significant lending during the pandemic that got critical capital into communities and into households. With the level of inflation that we're experiencing, what are you seeing now that small businesses are saying they need to be able to continue to support operations or labor or other costs that they have, indirect costs that they may have to sustain and grow their businesses? What are some of the challenges and what are some of the opportunities?
So Carrie, we partner with the SBA with four women's business centers out of 160 that they host across the country. We also host the Small Business Transportation Resource Center for USDOT. Those two programs combined allow us to support over 5,000 minority and women-owned businesses annually. And so those businesses range from startups to those who want to scale and eventually sell their business. What we often hear is obviously the lack of capital is still a problem. I think there's a huge opportunity for more commercial banks to engage with community development financial institutions. We're not seeing as much as I think we'd like. It has obviously gotten a whole lot better over the last 20 years. But that is an area of opportunity, I believe, for commercial banks to engage. My biggest worry is the Secretary of State for North Carolina likes to talk about how the last 2 years, 3 years actually, we broke records in terms of the number of new business startups. Many states have experienced this. And so speaking of the labor market, they're not returning to the labor market. They're starting their own businesses. And if you peel open who's starting businesses, you'll find that it's women who are leading the way in terms of starting new businesses. If you peel open that, you'll find that it's women of color. And so these are highly degreed, highly connected, skilled individuals who are choosing to lead the workforce and create their own business. And it used to be 90% were sole proprietors. That's changed. Now they're actually hiring people. And so we're seeing that happen as well. My worry with that, though, is when they leave corporate and start their business, what I'm often finding is that they're using their savings. They're pulling from their 401k. Instead of leveraging those resources when they start their business to have a longer runway. We know 20% of businesses fail first year. We know another 30 are gone within 3 years, half make it to 55 years. And so how do we create a longer runway for them? They've got to learn how to use capital and leverage capital. So financial literacy goes even further than just the personal, but how do you use it in business to further your runway? So I think that's a challenge that we're seeing a lot. That's impacting also the number of companies that come to us. Now, there's a lot of pent-up demand for diverse business owners to get capital. And so banks are coming to us saying, we'll extend capital to you to put in these communities because our underwriting sometimes is challenged getting to those populations. Great example of that is for many CDFIs, they can go down to a 600 credit score. Commercial banks are not going to 600. They may do 650. They're not. They're definitely not talking about financing startup businesses right now. They're not talking to restaurants right now. We found a huge niche with food trucks. I love food trucks. And the only catch I have with food trucks is they have to give me free food. Have to sample what we're lending against. And so when we run into these niche opportunities like that in the marketplace, that creates jobs. And so it benefits commercial banks if they've made loans to CDFIs, and then we can put that capital in the communities. I was talking with bankers recently, Carrie, at OFN about that, because I said, you know, in the last 2.5 years, we've probably made about $20 million in loans. We've had 2 defaults. I said, now, how many of y'all can say that? And they all started looking in the ceiling. But part of the reason for that is for many small business owners, when they get to a CDFI, they know that's their last resort. We're the last stop. And so you have got to do whatever you can to pay that loan back. We're also much closer in the community. We're engaged with them. And so that, I'm going to see you in the grocery store. I know your children. I had a CDFI leader tell me recently that he needed a loan, and he took his son and his grandson and his granddaughter with him to the banker. I said, well, why'd you do that? I said, I had them all crying. This is about generational wealth. And look at what you have an opportunity to impact. I said, that is a brilliant strategy. So now I've got to figure out how to get my kids to start having children so I can take my grandchildren with me to banker meetings. But those are the challenges that I'm seeing. We're seeing a slowdown a little bit because of the interest rates. I was doing 6-7% rates before the pandemic or at the beginning. Now we're more like 8-10. And many CDFIs live on a very tight margin. 2% roughly is what we're living on. So when banks increase my rate, I have no choice but go up a little bit.
Yeah, we heard some about that yesterday at the conference, and in other conversations that I've had out on the road. Tom and I have hosted several conversations with CDFIs to just learn more about the issues, the opportunities. And just a plug, we released our 2023 CDFI survey recently. And so talking more about the demand is there, but, you know, what are the barriers that prevent folks from being able to access it? One of the things that also just really came up prominently in conversations this week at OFN was that several of these CDFIs are trying to refinance small business owners, particularly minority small business owners, out of bad debt. So they're just trying to refinance them out of predatory debt. And so that's one of the biggest opportunities, I think, ahead of us. But it's still a challenge in this higher cost of capital environment. So I want to thank
you. It's bad debt and factoring.
Yes. Yes.
Factoring is hugely, hugely predatory. And so we're trying to get them out of those situations so they can grow.
Absolutely. I want to see, so thank you so much to our panel for this discussion. But before we wrap our panel, I want to see if there are any audience questions specifically for any of our panelists. Yes, Tom. Yeah. Yeah, so I'll state the question for those who are on the live stream. The question was around factoring, and Kevin, if you can explain some more about what you mean related to small business owners in that.
So for many small business owners, going to a commercial bank to get a loan as a startup is next to impossible. And so if they've gotten a contract from someone that is a performance contract where they're selling a widget, they're making a dollar on that widget, they can factor, meaning I'll sell that and I'll make 30 cents on the dollar for that contract. But it almost becomes to the point where you can't get out. You can never get ahead with factoring. And so we're trying to get them more level set to debt should be a smaller portion of what you do and not drive your business.
Any additional questions, Tom?
Both for Neil and for Nancy. So basic economics, if you talked about the labor market, would say you're short frontline workers, so you raise their pay. When you raise their pay, you either attract more frontline workers or you find yourself investing in more automation or different staffing models to reduce the number. And eventually you get to an equilibrium. Okay, so what I heard you both describe is that we're not at an equilibrium. And I just, how far are we from a place where the demand and the supply come together at whatever wage rate it is? And what are your members saying, Nancy? Neil, what are you hearing from your property managers?
I'll jump in. That's okay.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a great question. Something that we struggle with. We don't know if increasing wage, I mean, you can increase wages at some point, right? And you'll attract everybody, right? Of course, right? But at the margin, we're not seeing that increasing wages is the issue. It's more about flexibility, working remote, you know, those other things, and just the job itself. It's a very difficult job. We all know that. I'm not sure that's, there's a number there, but I would say, you know, maybe if you increased it by 50%, I think it would be that much. Yeah. Because we're competing with, like, I'll paint a picture for you. We're competing with a job where somebody's working as an administrative assistant at a medical office. So they're sitting, you know, there, you know, sitting all day, and just, you know, it's a nice job, versus our team members have to obviously work all day on their feet, moving side to side, have to take care of the guests, provide that exceptional service. I think it's a challenging job, in my opinion.
And I would agree. I mean, same thing with retail. And I appreciate what you said, Neil, about, you know, you look at the hospitality industry as a career. And that's the mentality that we have to instill in both retail and hospitality, that this could be a career. This isn't just, you know, working to get on to your next job. But with that, if the small business, you know, owner wants to see it that way, and someone just used a great term, they said, we hire to retire. And I thought, that's brilliant. So in their mind, they're going to spend money on education and training. And that's whether it's service or retail. But they have to have this mindset of, if you're going to retain, it's not just always about money. It's about, are you affording them flexibility? Are you growing them both personally and professionally so that they feel like they can use this as a career and a stepping stone? And so I agree with you. I don't know if you're ever going to see that number, but it's really, I think it's up to our business owners to be able to look at their staff and what their needs are, and then weigh, is that something I can invest in automation, right? Let's talk about automation, everybody, you know, robots coming into, you know, play. And so, you know, where do I draw the line on efficiencies and automation? And then human capital. So it's an ever growing challenge. But what we see, and again, the, you know, I'll refer back to the research we did in July. There's a whole section on culture and innovation and maximizing efficiencies and what our small business. And we had, by the way, had way over 100 businesses. So we have some good data that we can sink our teeth into. And in that data, though, 19% of our small business community is still not embracing or adopting technologies or efficiencies. And that's where we have to help them. It's just like accessing capital. And again, financial literacy is key. What's your credit look? So these are all things that we as business owners have to look into and ask our people, what do you need? And what's it going to take to keep you here? Hope that answered.
I think we have time for maybe one more question with some quick answers, and then we're going to transition into small table breakouts and sharing back in from the questions. So, Joseph, I see you in the back.
Great. Thank you. Good afternoon. Appreciate the presentation. For the three of you, I've heard winners, losers, those with access to, those without access to capital, high-wage earners, low-wage earners. From a low-income consumer perspective or a low-income community member, they're still not dealing with a post-pandemic recovery. They're still dealing with systemic challenges pre-pandemic. From your perspective, systemically, we have seen that those with access to means prior to the pandemic significantly benefited from the economic situation. Those who were low-income prior to are still not quarters, but probably years or decades into really having a recovery benefit. Systemically, what could or should be done in order to really even the situation and provide greater opportunities?
Well,
capital.
Well, I think we've got to rethink some things. You know, what I woke up with this morning was this bell-shaped curve of, at the front, you have entry-level workers and on the, and then you rise to your highest wage that you can earn, and then you go back down to being retired. Problem with being retired, and my father used to remind me of this all the time. He said, I'm never retiring. And the problem with it is your income, for the most part, gets stuck there. You get a little increase, but not as fast as cost. And so all of a sudden, you get priced out of your home that you've lived in for 30, 40 years. And we've had some conversation with elected officials about, why aren't we considering more ADUs, accessory dwelling units, to allow people to live on their property longer? Now they have additional income that they can use to pay property taxes, to pay for their medicines that keep going up, all of those things. But we haven't found the right mechanism to finance ADUs. It gets a little challenging. So I think things like that, we got to rethink the traditional roles that we've played with finance and how we respond to the population as we all age. 10,000 of us are at retirement age every day, even though we don't. But how do we prepare for that?
Yeah, sure. Real quickly, we have time if you want to chime in, Nancy. And
real quick chime in. It goes back to the small business mentality. That does a crazy number about women opening businesses and how many people you're serving. So congratulations. When someone opens a business, and I was just on a 2-hour call today, we distribute some funding to you know, lower minority businesses. And several of the people that were making their business presentations are working full-time jobs. One's an ER nurse, and then she bakes sweets at night. You know, and so these are people who have these aspirations of maybe graduating from their livelihood position and into a new job. But what we have to make sure they understand that it's also not just about making money and making ends meet in your business. It's about building wealth for you and your family. And I think that's the line that we miss so many times, is that it's not about opening multiple stores all the time. Everyone's like, to scale. I want to scale. Get that word out of your brain. Focus on your business and building wealth for you and your family. And that's a big difference between having a profitable balance sheet, but really building wealth.
I'm just going to say one more thing. Yeah, I agree with the comments, but I think the only thing I would add is that what we see is that transportation is a big impediment. There's a lot of great high-paying jobs in certain parts of the region or the Commonwealth or the district. And then there's obviously population in a different area. And if we can, that's a cost for these people, right? So if we can solve that problem, I think there's a tremendous opportunity there.
Great point. We hear a lot about transportation, particularly in smaller towns and rural areas, but it's not unique to small towns and rural areas. It's an urban challenge as well. I want to thank our panel for joining us. Thank you so much, Neil, Nancy, Kevin. We appreciate your comments. We're now going to transition to the part of the event where we hear directly from our audience members as well. And so you have two questions at your table. We'll have about 20 to 25 minutes for you all to discuss the two questions. And as you are thinking about those two questions, we'll ask you to have someone at your table be designated as the person who can report out at the end, because we'd love for you to report out your thoughts around the two questions to Governor Bowman and Tom, who are with us, so they can take your feedback under advisement as they're thinking about next steps and ways in which the Federal Reserve Bank can continue to support community and economic conditions. And so the two questions are at your table, but for those who are online, we'll be back after a quick break. I also want to note what the two questions were in case you want to consider them while you're online. The first question for the tables is, how do you assess the level of economic optimism in the business or community you represent? What are the most prominent concerns of people in your community at present? The second question is, how are households and communities responding to the higher prices of many essential items like food, housing, and transportation? And do you see folks adjusting their spending in material ways? So we'll take some time for discussion, and we'll be back at about 2:35 to share out the feedback from those discussions. Thanks so much. back, everyone. Welcome back. And I'm going to ask you to just wrap up your final thoughts of your discussion. I'll give about 30 seconds for you to wrap up your final thoughts here. Okay, so I'm going to ask you to finalize your conversations. It looks like there are a bunch of good conversations happening. I heard everything from housing to, I think, Beyonce tickets. So it sounds like there was an interesting conversation had by all. I want to, again, remind those on the live stream, and I understand we have about 150 people joining us via live stream. So we've got a great audience that's online as well. But the questions were, I'm going to ask Governor Bowman and Tom if you'll come back and join us as tables report out. The questions were, how do you assess the level of economic optimism in the business or community you represent, and some of the most pressing concerns of the people in the communities that you represent? And then how are households and communities responding to higher prices of many essential items like food, housing, and transportation? And do you see really adjusting spending in material ways? So we're curious what you've had to say around that. And we're going to go around and just do a report out. I'm going to sit down, but I'm going to ask if we can report out starting with this table and then working our way around here. After the report out, I think we'll still have some additional time for Q&A as well, but we'll look and monitor. So we're going to start with this table. If each table could take about 3 minutes to do their report out on how you how the discussion unfolded with those two questions. Thanks so much.
And it'd be useful for us to just hear what sectors were represented in your table so we know where you're coming from.
Can you hear me? So my name is Kevrick Jones. I work at PNC in real estate banking. And
Rashonda Lanier Jackson with the Corporation for Supportive Housing.
And interestingly, we kind of represent, I guess, opposite ends of the same spectrum or the same industry. I work in financing large corporate owners of market rate real estate. So whether that be multifamily, industrial, office, hospitality, I know was represented on the panel. And Rashonda's group helps with, some of our most disadvantaged citizens in terms of creating an environment for them to have stability and hopefully economic opportunity on top of that stability. And in thinking about answering the question, both of us expressed a very pessimistic viewpoint from our industries. From my standpoint, the cost of capital, the cost of materials, labor, really impacts the ability to make a return on investments. I had mentioned at the table that there's a pretty long gestation period for projects from start to finish. And we're seeing a lot of projects go on hold to even being shuttered altogether. Because of the lack of capital from banks like the one that I work at. And then just tying that through to Rashonda's work, her organization is partially a CDFI, which does get investment, from, larger financial institutions, which to my understanding, has waned in addition to philanthropic support, but a lot of capital is being reserved because of the aforementioned issues on the asset and pricing side and being able to have those investments see through to, you know, their expectations. And so, pretty bleak view and a lot of concerns in, you know, looking through the crystal ball over the next 12, 24, 36 months.
Appreciate that. And so with the Corporation for Supportive Housing, we're talking about housing some of our most vulnerable. And so those that with housing but without services, they would not be able to maintain that housing. And if they have services but they don't have housing, that also prohibits their ability to thrive. And so the populations that we tend to serve are those with serious mental illness, those who have developmental delays, youth that are transitioning out of foster care, substance abuse, formerly incarcerated, as well as our seniors that may be on limited income and have health challenges. And some of the economic themes that we're seeing, you often hear about workforce housing, but this is typically not that population. And this probably isn't new, but you know, the lack of housing stock that is available, and not just the lack of housing stock, but the lack of the quality in the housing stock. The high rent prices, you know, we see where some landlords have set prices just above what the housing voucher will allow. And so though we have this policy now where you cannot discriminate against income sources, we see the prices being set just above that housing voucher. You know, zoning ordinances, and that makes it difficult for the lack of type of housing. We always see a lot of single family housing, which doesn't always work for the population that we're striving to serve. Wages, you know, haven't kept up with the housing costs. And this includes for our frontline workers in the sense of our case managers, our service providers, as well as property managers. We hear about, you know, property managers and case managers going to for profit because they can offer them $5 more or, you know, $6 more. And so just losing like great service providers and people in the housing field because of the lack of wages that are available. Also seeing our service providers on services. So they themselves that are doing case management are also on public assistance. And then, you know, just decrease in stock of private landlords. And so whether that's the stigma that, you know, was there around folks who have low income or are using vouchers, case managers oftentimes find themselves having to develop a relationship with the landlord to talk to them about the tenant and who this person is so that they will rent to them. The raising rents and then again, losing private landlords because they were able to sell their home in this economy.
You're canceling projects that might have otherwise gone through. One of the big challenges we've got in housing is the cost of construction and the availability of contractors and subcontractors. I'm not sure if you see it all the way through or not, but do you see the impact of those cancellations on freeing up availability to perhaps get, you know, more stuff built? That'd be part of the theory of, you know, how you adjust the economy back to normal.
Yeah, we definitely are experiencing that. And as an institution, we cover directly, you know, some of the, you know, largest kind of landholders, developers, et cetera. And, you know, those groups who tend to be some of the best capitalized in the country are having to be highly selective with what projects they put forth and which ones they do not, to the extent that, you know, they may mothball 90% of their projects and there's just one golden child. That, you know, then they're coming with almost a sense of desperation to their capital providers, like, this is so meaningful to our business. And so it's not just construction cost. That is a material factor. The cost of capital, so obviously interest rate environment, but then also cost of insurance, which I think has been, is being reported, but it's sort of underreported in terms of the relative effect on our industry, especially in certain areas that are deemed high growth, right? And so the Smile States, Florida, Texas, et cetera, the West Coast as well, you're seeing insurance, you know, cost double like year over year because of the lack of availability. And so when you compound all these things on top of each other, along with the lack of ability to just be able to pass it through to the consumer, a lot of things just, you know, aren't viable today.
Great. Good afternoon, Joseph. We had a great conversation right away that really tied in both of the questions, but three key components from the first question. The first one is that we understand that there are two very different levels of optimism. They're two completely different segments of society. So on the one hand, those who started the pandemic with high income and high wealth have significantly benefited from the pandemic situation and the post-pandemic recovery. Those who started the pandemic with significantly less income and zero or minus wealth are in a pessimistic perspective because of the affordability of housing crisis that pretty much every single jurisdiction in the country focuses, but also at the same time, the pessimism as to whether the American dream through homeownership can still be achieved. We continue to see lower levels of primarily low-income Black and brown community members being able to own their own home, which we all know is the best way to create wealth, or systemically has been the best wealth. We also focus on what are some of the concerns right now, and there are two key ones. One, crime. We continue to see rampant crime taking over pretty much every single major metropolitan area in the country. And that has to do with lack of economic mobility. We cannot simply move away and say insurance companies will pay for what gets stolen. We know that there is a systemic a justice system situation being involved. And lastly, just coming back to the housing affordability, if we know that home ownership is not the fastest or best way to create wealth in this country, then we got to look at access to capital for small business entrepreneurs, but it cannot be stuck in the same mentality that small business entrepreneurs are those with collateral, with cash flows, with high credit scores. There are a lot of side hustles that exist that need to be institutionalized, and that would require for not only the economic system, CDFIs, and banks to rethink what is the trustworthiness of a borrower.
Could I ask follow up on that? Are those side hustles helping to support the increased prices, increased costs? Are they necessary, or is it something that's a passion, a business development passion?
A lot of times it's a necessity or the only way to legally generate income, whether it's an undocumented community member, whether it's a returning citizen, whether it is a single mom taking care of kids at home. That's the only way on how to generate income. And that's the other key component we discuss here, that we are seeing, because of the significant higher housing prices, that poverty is being exported to neighboring jurisdictions. So from the economic perspective, a city or a county might look better, but that simply means that they have attracted primarily well-educated, affluent, white community members, when those who, through multiple generations, have been left behind have simply been forced to look elsewhere.
Thank you.
Okay, at this table, we had folks representing the food processing, production industry, ice cream and hospitality, and affordable housing development, operation and resident services. Economic optimism is trending positively in the consumers. Sales have increased, which indicates consumer optimism. Staffing challenges have required greater understanding, flexibility and adaptability, including salary benefits and creating a sense of value and belonging among employees, which is evaluated through employee surveys. Business owners, particularly those launching businesses or nascent businesses, tend to be optimistic by nature. Stabilized prices are contributing to economic optimism. Price increases are causing lower income folks to make difficult and or dangerous decisions, including making cuts in optional purchases, end quotes. Anything I'm missing?
I think we spoke to the pessimism from a housing perspective and at our table, and the impacts that I think the gentleman at table two, Joseph, said it best, in terms of that there seems to be a disparity between, honestly, the sections of our society, that lower income folks, the optimism may not be there, and higher income earners are seeing optimism. So I think that was a consistent theme at our table.
It's on now. All right. Our table is mostly banking, and then myself representing local business, primarily retail. I wouldn't say that we were overly pessimistic, but I would say it's trending towards that. There's kind of a caution in the air, and that was evaluated through less risk for business. While they may be seeing okay paper performance, there's a diminishing cash flow issue that keeps bubbling up, and that is becoming more and more apparent in terms of businesses being willing to take on investment or risk. And that's kind of coupled by a couple of different things, you know, cash flow, but also labor and higher rates are kind of discouraging those investments. And then I think we see similar sentiments in retail where they're having to increase prices or pass things on to the consumer, and they're feeling that with either spending being flat or down. And I think that's about it on that top piece. But I think we spoke a little to the CARES Act withdrawal, and that there's a bit of a cliff happening there, and that influence on businesses and those that made decisions with that influence of that availability of those funds are now coming off, and how are they going to be able to adjust to that?
That's really concerning, I think, especially as we think about going into maybe a slower, potentially at some point. The data right now looks quite good, but as we're looking at entering a slower economic period, would you expect then that there might be some exiting of businesses from the marketplace, or is it that dramatic, the impact?
Yeah, I do think we were talking about kind of the second half of 24, definitely starting to see a little bit of that, certainly within our markets, just due to the, the unwillingness to take that additional risk on the part of the business folks. And
you said 24, did you mean 23? You mean this year, or are you saying for
next year? I mean, the thought that the excess liquidity, I mean, we're starting to see that spend down, at least my personal opinion is that we've got probably another quarter or two of that before it's truly depleted. And I think that's when, the second half of next year becomes a little more negative. Not horrible, just a little more negative. Is that fair?
Thank you.
Good afternoon. We had maybe slightly different perspectives at our table, representatives from banking, chamber, black restaurant owners, and government funders and nonprofit funders. And then I'm in a fair housing, fair lending space. I would say that there's probably more pessimism at our table, if that's an understatement, recognizing the challenges of housing in the region. And that's at all stratas. That's from home ownership, for those that have historically been excluded from home ownership, to those that are, kids of friends of bankers that are having trouble finding housing. In the rental space, we've seen astronomical increases in rentals. There was a study that was done last year on the changes in ownership. And so in some segments of the city of Richmond, more than 25% of the houses that were sold were from owner-occupied to LLC. A lot of the apartment complexes are being bought up by out-of-state property management owners and being run with policies that are coming from out-of-state. And so what we're seeing are eviction policies that are more draconian than they used to be, where you used to be able to talk to a property management manager and say, hey, I've had a bad month, can I get you next month? Even at a large complex, they say, yeah, we can work with you. And now they're saying, no, our new owner's policy is we file the pay or quit. If we don't get them payment, we file the unlawful detainer after that, and we take you to court. And so that's driving some of the eviction rates in the area. And then we're seeing displacement because of increased property assessments, even in parts of the city that haven't seen investments made, specifically in Southside Richmond, where we've seen property assessments go up, even though there hasn't been a change in the landscape there. With regards to, one of the issues was, are employers pushing to have a change in the housing landscape? Will we see a change where companies like Lego won't come here because, or other companies might say might not expand here because there's just not affordable housing. And that sparked a conversation then about what does it cost for childcare or for elder care as well, and those other factors that go into the cost of doing business. Someone referenced a study that said that, I think it was JLARC that recently did a study, our Joint Legislative Auditing and Review Commission for the state, and they did a study that said that those on the lower incomes just can't afford childcare. And what does that do for the labor market then? And that's becoming more of a factor. I learned a new phrase, pay in four. And the idea that people, the old layaway idea that you buy now and you'll pay it later. And that's where the Beyonce tickets came up, more and more people are trying to find creative ways to be able to buy something now. And they don't always have access to the traditional credit markets. And so what does that do for those that are uncredited or credit invisible when they are engaging in these sometimes not as well-regulated market or products? And what does that do for their abilities down the road too? And so quite concerned about that. And I'll end with a kind of an anecdote, but I think it's telling, which is it seems like more people are bringing their lunches to work. And not going out for lunch. And that's at the teller level, that's at the executive level, more and more. It's little things on the margins, but that's probably having a big impact. And it's probably having an impact on our restaurants. And so I'd ask the question, what does this term factoring mean? But that is definitely impacting Black-owned restaurants that are taking these loans based on expectation of sales and the pressure that puts as well. And so they're often in a less regulated product there, and the potential for real impact on those borrowers.
So I have a question maybe for your table or maybe for everybody. I think I hear pessimism. I think I hear housing. I think I hear a lot that sounds a lot like what I would hear during a recession. On the other hand, unemployment in this country is 3.8%. Wage gains have been pronounced, particularly for those at entry level. And those of you who pay people entry level know the wage gains have been high, even higher than inflation in a lot of segments. Inflation, which was a sentiment bummer a year and a half ago, has dropped by 2/3. And so I just love any reflections on, in a world where unemployment is 3.8%, by the way, if you take a 50-year perspective, that's very close to the low. Where inflation's at 3.7%, if you take a 50-year perspective, that's pretty much at the average. Interest rates are at, whatever they are, at a 50-year perspective, that's about the average, right? So why are we all, and I mean, I think I hear it, but I'd just like to reflect on why is the mood so somber? Yeah.
Yeah, I think we haven't mentioned one thing, and that's how I experience volatility. It feels as if we're in a more volatile world.
Excellent.
And in a world that where we've already learned from the great financial crisis that there's international exposures that we can't foresee. Mm-hmm. And so I think some of the pessimism is because of that. Mm-hmm. While those numbers sound great, everyone doesn't experience it, or tomorrow might be a vastly different than what you're experiencing today.
Uncertainty, volatility. It's been such a guardrail to guardrail 3 years. Yeah.
Yeah, I would just echo that. And, one of the questions that I was thinking of during the panel discussion and the notion of, traditional hospitality workers exiting that for rideshare, right? And so the question of stability, and if you tie that to housing, the challenge with housing is that the stock for affordable, like first time home ownership, is like non-existent in most markets, particularly high growth markets. And the quote about what I call bulk purchasers, or I think LLC purchasers, corporate purchasers of housing, in some high growth markets, appears to be, call it a for sale subdivision, these things are getting bought up wholesale by private equity firms. And so someone can be employed, and that can cause low employment, but they can still be underemployed in that they're not getting you know, 40 plus hours with benefits, et cetera. And so if that is the case, you know, that, you know, your kind of per capita cost load of inflation hits that employee person different than it did in the past. And then, and I forget your name, I'm sorry. Nancy mentioned the need for wealth building, wealth creation, which home ownership for the vast majority of citizens was a pathway towards, but that has fundamentally changed since the Great Recession. And so I think, you know, it really comes down to the whole health of a citizen, and stability is a big part of that.
I just wanted to add, when you talk about the pessimism, I use social media to kind of gauge things in my outreach and engagement at the Commonwealth Institute. And one meme that I see constantly coming up on my timeline is about Black Friday. And they're like, we have enough TVs, we have enough big items. Could you please put the groceries on sale for Black Friday this year? And so I say that to say that it's the immediate needs that people are seeing. They're not seeing the decreases on. So like the paper towels, the toilet paper, the groceries, the small things that we need every day. And those are the things that are in folks' faces all the time.
I think the other factor is, to the gentleman who just spoke, is the inequities are greater now than they were 4 years ago. And so while there might be, you know, if you own a house and you're watching Zillow, you're seeing your price increase go up every year. That's great. That's what we talked about at the table. But if you don't own a house, then all you're seeing is that entry into the housing market. And we're seeing more and more, I mean, I talk about it often, but the racial homeownership gap is greater now than it was 55 years ago when the Fair Housing Act was passed. So when you look at the percentage of Black households that own their houses versus the percentage of white households that own their houses, that gap is greater now than it was 55 years ago. And so the segments that some of us are serving are feeling the housing crunch much, much more strongly than others.
Tom, just quick question. As we see this wave of corporations and LLCs that bought up single family houses, I guess because of all of this pent up capital they had and needed to put it somewhere, so they did that. When do you think that will start waning? Because we're already seeing the backlash of neighborhood associations rising up saying, no more of that in my neighborhood, and changing their rules in their communities. But do you anticipate a sell-off of those single-family houses by these corporations in the near future, or what's your outlook on that?
I'll give you mine, but I'm not sure I'm an expert in it. But as I have interviewed the people who run those companies, what I heard them say is, just like a house is an investment opportunity for you and me, a house is an investment opportunity for them, that they could buy it, rent it, pay the operating costs, make some margin on that, and sell it when the price was right. And so they're just, you know, if you want to think about it, they're just a corporation behaving like individuals behave in creating wealth, you know, out of their housing. By the way, people are living in that housing. They're not owning it with the rent, you know, with the wealth potential, but they are renting it and they are living in the housing. So I don't think of it as taking housing off the market, assuming it's a well-behaved landlord and that kind of stuff. But I do see it as, you know, private capital taking advantage of some of the wealth creation opportunities that many of us would like individuals to be able to do. That's how I think about it. When are they going to sell it? I think that's a business proposition. I guess it's possible that neighborhoods could put rental restrictions on places and therefore take that business out. That feels very difficult to me. When does the price get to a level where they want to sell it? Where does the economic formula work at a place where they no longer want to buy it? I think those are those sorts of questions. I think they're very hard questions to navigate, because I just think it's private capital, and it's not new, it's just scaled. Private capital taking advantage of the opportunity that it was individual capital that was taking advantage of.
I might just make an observation that it's not easy to be a landlord, especially if you have homes in different geographic locations or that are in disparate neighborhoods or in different places. I imagine that the attractiveness of this type of investment will certainly have its dusk, right? I think there was a real acceleration in the valuation of residential real estate across the country, and it became an opportunity. I think there are cycles, and I my expectation is that we will see it. I don't know when, but I imagine that we will see it. I wondered, and there was one thing that was really poignant, I thought, from the table that I sat at, where we were talking about related to the uncertainty and the volatility. And I think it's behaviors of individuals and discourse. And I wondered if one of them might be willing to just make a comment on how that's evolving.
Because I thought I would be able to avoid that, Mickey.
it was really relevant.
We don't have a big consumer lending business, so I was just trying to provide some anecdotal evidence to how might the consumer economic fortunes be. And one of the things that we see with the customers who come to our branches, the level of incivility, anger, frustration spills out. And then it infects a little bit of the civility among our staff. And we come to the defense of our employees because, you know, these are the frontline employees like those of you in retail. And so it's important that we protect them. But as a behavioral observation, you wonder if that's not an indicator of the economic fortunes or difficulties that the consumers are facing. And I would add, one of the things that I would observe is that every one of the industries that many people work in are radically changing. Look at banking, post-SVB, the community banking business model is changing. Media, restaurants, technology is disrupting, AI. So there's also lots of other uncertainties and concern on the part of consumers. And so I think that's what we're seeing bubble up to some degree.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, you know, it's a good event when people want to stay longer than the event is scheduled to last. So thank you to all of you all. Thank you so much. Really, really, really great discussion. Thank you to those of you who joined us for Fed Listens on the live stream. Governor Bowman, Tom, thank you so much for the opportunity to hear from folks. This is not a one-time thing. We want to continue to hear from our residents and business owners and leaders across the 5th District and across the country. So continue to stay in partnership with us. Our team looks forward to continuing to work with you on research, on data, on insights that advance opportunities for communities to thrive. And so I thank you all, and that concludes our Fed Lessons session.